Good morning and welcome to this, the ninth meeting of the Equality and Human Rights Committee. Can I make the usual request that mobile phones are switched off or onto airplane mode? We have received apologies this morning from two of our colleagues, Alex Cole-Hamilton and Annie Wells. Moving on swiftly to our substantive item this morning, agenda item one is to take a decision to take agenda item four in private, which is our discussion on the evidence we hear. Agreed? Okay, agenda item two is the inquiry that we have ongoing. We have had an informal briefing this morning from some people that are involved in the sector, in the healthcare sector and the support and social care sector. So we are very happy to have some more evidence today on this inquiry on the record. With us this morning, we have Suzanne Miller. Now, Suzanne, you are the Chief Officer for Strategy, Planning and Commission at Glasgow City Health and Social Care Partnership. Good morning. Alistair Muir, who's the Chief Inspector with Police Scotland. Derek Mitchell is the Chief Officer with Causeless Strategic Migration Partnership. Good morning, Derek. And with Olivia Nandotti this morning, we have Natalia Jane Farmer, who's a social work researcher. And Olivia is a service user with ASH, the Asylum Seeker Housing Project. Can I thank you all for coming along this morning? Can I thank you all for the written evidence that some of you have provided? This inquiry has been ongoing now for a few weeks, and we're really keen to hear from you this morning. But maybe as an opener, as an opening question, we'd maybe get Natalia to tell us a wee bit about the project and the work that you're doing with Olivia to set the scene, and then maybe hear from some of the statutory organisations and the work that you do around that. Natalia, would you like to start?
Sure. Okay, so I'm a social work researcher at Glasgow Caledonian University, and my research is located at the Asylum Seeker Housing Project, which was originally set up in 2014 in response to the growing concerns of asylum accommodation with Serco. However, during my research time there, a lot of what I've been focusing on is people with no recourse to public funds and their specific interaction with social services and local authority. So it's been accompanying them through the assessment process and in numerous social work meetings. So in particular, my involvement with Olivia since June of last year has been quite a grueling fight to secure Olivia housing, accommodation and appropriate financial support. So there's numerous issues that we feel welcome, that, you know, we're really grateful to be here to highlight some of the issues that we've been facing and some of the issues that my research has been flagging up, really.
Thank you, Natalia. Now, Olivia, you and I know each other quite well now over the past few years, and I know some of your journey. But if you're able to tell us this morning about your journey and where you are now and some of the issues that you've come across and the support that you've had.
Okay. All right. So my journey is mainly getting involved with the community, volunteering more with the community work because of, I think, the inhumane treatment will push you through doing things that you never thought that you end up doing in life. Right now, my journey, where I am right now, I think the other story, which has already been covered up, is... it's trying to, like, living basically totally with nothing, with a baby, and on the budget of £25 a week. So that's like £50 every fortnight, which is very hard. And that's like just for the baby, not myself. And thankfully, we've been offered accommodation finally, which the accommodation came this January on the 23rd. But it's just things that I've had to go through with social work, and just to access this accommodation with a baby is something that I thought has just been like a very disturbing factor for myself and for the mothers that I've seen before. So basically right now, I'm still volunteering, I'm still active. I think I'm standing strong here where I am is because of being involved with different community networks, the agencies that I've seen helping to support other women. And that's why I'm so strong for myself as well, because I've had knowledge to know where I need to go for support. And at least I think you can understand my English is a bit okay, so I could speak up for myself. And that's why I'm still standing, and the baby's healthy, thankfully. I've just done a finished a 9 routine checkup with the doctors, and he's okay. I've passed that with the doctors, so thank you. But still, it's still a disturbing factor to know that I'm still on that budget of like a £25 a week with a baby, who's actually now like a British citizen because of his father, and he's got his British passport. It's still a disturbing factor because we still have barriers. We can't access anything.
One of the things this committee has been really interested in, Olivia, is people who have been through the system found themselves in a destitution situation where they've had no recourse to public funds and no support, statutory support, where they've sought that support from friends and from charities and from organisations. I know that you have experienced some of that destitution and you've had to seek that support. Would you be able to tell us a wee bit about how you came through that?
How I came through that is, it's the network, being in the community. There's always someone supporting you, and you have to go and make inquiries what support you can get. Even if you've made inquiries from trying to get support, extra support from the Home Office, it's like you're not entitled to this support. But I've been lucky, I've had positive action housing, which had to go that extra mile asking people from their own houses, and whereby they had a spare room. So even before the baby came, I've lived through very good people who've been doctors and lawyers at the same time in their houses. They've accommodated me in a spare room. And I've accessed the food banks and the charity being there to support me as well. It's gone on until when I was pregnant, and so I missed out even the maternity grant. I raised my baby inside my tummy with nothing through support from the community and charity organisations, squeezing him into my same clothes, which were size 12. I had to wear stretchy clothes because I couldn't buy the extra maternity clothes, and I tried to access that money. It was non-accessible. Even getting the referrals that I had through to social work for extra support of whatever I needed, I never got that. Even until the baby came, it was like a really hard road to go through and fight through. And even I'm not still impressed with the support that I'm actually getting right now.
How did that whole experience affect you, Olivia?
I think my mum, may she rest in peace, being in heaven, she was a diplomat who was a very strong woman. And looking at her work that she's done when we were growing up, and every time I've tried to cry alone in the room, I feel like there was a voice telling me, I raised you better than that, dry your tears. Just you've got to speak to someone. So that's how I kept on. Really, another campaign was going around myself, knocking on every organisation, making phone calls, emails through my MSPs, my MPs, and organisations just to get the answer why I was going through that. And even when I've explained my situation, I'm not an illegal immigrant. I've been granted temporary leave to remain with the Home Office. So why can't I even get just a little bit of support? And never happened. So I think it's just been yourself. You can't explain how you had that feeling whereby maybe an hour you just covered yourself under the blanket, and then a few minutes you're getting up, washing your face, and reading a book that inspired you to say you can do something, you know, just stay strong. So I've never had the thoughts of actually going through wanting to kill myself over suicidal thoughts. I never had those because I always, as a Christian, I've always believed it's wrong. So that's been my strongest, I think, fight as well, whereby I didn't think of getting my life off to say, but I just thought it wasn't worth living. Most of the time it was like, this is not what everybody else should go through. And when I became pregnant, it became worse off as well. And going through having a partner who was quite abusive, it just became like, maybe it's because of my immigration status, that's why this person is actually taking advantage of my situation. And then still I didn't get more support through what I went through with the domestic abuse. So I found myself still fighting for my life, staying alive and staying awake. And I didn't know when my life was going to end, but I can't believe I'm still here. That's my miracle for myself, saying I can't believe I'm actually still here with the things that I've gone through. actually on the streets outside there. I can't believe I'm still here. So,
well, we're glad you're here this morning to share your story with us. Very glad. You're still standing, as you say, you're still standing where you are.
Yes.
Olivia, I'm going to move on, but some of our colleagues may come back and ask you some more questions, okay? Derek, COSLA. We had one of your colleagues in last week from COSLA who had explained some of the aspects of the work that he does. Your work's slightly different, so could you maybe give us a wee overview and then maybe elaborate?
Yeah, I suppose Andy's specific tasks and responsibilities in the team has been around asylum and some refugee issues and taking a kind of leading role in Syrian resettlement. My job's a kind of wider role to kind of manage all issues. We deal with kind of corporate issues flowing from equalities and human rights for local government, for COSLA. But as Andy said last week, increasingly our work is focused on asylum and refugee issues over the last year or two. We play a central coordination role for our 32 councils in relation to Syrian resettlement. Another 200 came in a couple of weeks ago. There, 201, I think, come in a charter flight and have moved pretty seamlessly into the communities in 14 different local authority areas, so that's great. I think we're over 1,600 now, the Syrian refugees have come in since the start of the process. We also deal with issues flowing from unaccompanied asylum-seeking children and Lord Dubb's amendment and everything around that. And we've been the kind of liaison between 31 other councils out with Glasgow and the Home Office around the potential for widening asylum dispersal over a period of time. I think, as Andy said, you know, and we make no bones about this, you know, that there are absolutely issues that this inquiry will look at that you would want to address. The biggest single factor in that is that there's hundreds of millions of pounds being taken out of communities in the length and breadth of Britain with asylum contracts, and that money isn't there. So in the past, when Glasgow City Council ran the contract, Glasgow City Council provided a whole range of wraparound services and weren't funded to do so. We're funded in terms of, you know, the per person per night nature of the contract, but actually provided that wraparound service. And you saw Glasgow as a city become, you know, more cosmopolitan, you know, it moved away from the kind of the image that people had of Glasgow maybe 20 years ago and is a modern European city now, and asylum dispersal played a large part in that. But those resources aren't there any longer. And what we see is an asylum system that is fractured beyond repair, and that, you know, the UK government's position, and this isn't a party political point, I'd say here, successive UK governments have done the same. They've used destitution as a policy tool. And what happens then is that we then see that the consequences of this is that there's a cost shunt from national to local government and the third sector. And that's what we're seeing. And the direction of travel, unfortunately, is that that's only going to get worse. We've got an Immigration Act now, and there's processes in place for implementation of that. And when that happens, we're going to see things getting worse. And already stretched local government services are going to be stretched even further.
Mm-hmm. One of the things we're looking at in this inquiry is, obviously we know that immigration is a reserved matter and it's not a matter for this Parliament. However, it's all of the devolved services here that pick up the pieces of that, whether it's health or housing or social care or advice services or the charity, you know, the civic and charity sector. It seems to be that we seem to be picking up more of those pieces. So you're absolutely right, we're going to shine quite a bright light on all of that, and some folk won't like it. So, but we're quite keen to go ahead and do that anyway, but thanks, Derek. Suzanne, I want to come to you next, because Derek's obviously given us the overview of what COSLA does across 31 local authorities that are involved in that. Glasgow's always been a main dispersal place. We're concerned about when dispersal is widened, how we will deal with that. We had some people at committee last week who talked about the Syrian resettlement scheme and what an absolute gold standard that has been in treating people with humanity and compassion and with dignity and putting the right services in at the right time in order to allow integration and that seamlessness, you know, acceptance as well from the local communities. Because I know when I was involved with the Glasgow campaign to welcome refugees all those years ago, there's a big issue about how communities weren't prepared, and that caused some of the issues as well. But the Syrian resettlement programme seems to be a gold standard in that. And then you've got the rest. And I suppose from your point of view of being a local authority that's been at the forefront of this type of work for 20 odd years now, we're quite keen to find out where you think you make that difference. The differences between how one scheme works as opposed to all the other versions of asylum support or not in some cases, and how that can inform the work that we need to do. So we're putting a lot of focus on what you do, so we're expecting a lot from you this morning, but we hope you can facilitate that.
Okay, thanks, convener. Yeah, it's difficult to squeeze all of that in, as well as the title that you read out. I'm also Chief Social Work Officer for the City of Glasgow. I've been involved in asylum and refugee work in the city for the last 8 years, but you're right, our refugee asylum work really started when we met the first plane from Kosovo. The air ambulance plane that came from Kosovo. And I think since that point to where we are today, our city's been transformed, but also our approach in terms of best practice in relation to how we work with people seeking asylum and people who have refugee status has transformed. We've learned a lot over that period of time. We've got some things wrong, and I think we've put some things right, having learned some lessons from that. I think it does put us in a position, particularly in Scotland, but I would argue probably in the UK, of some expertise and experience in relation to best practice in terms of refugee and asylum work. We work really closely with colleagues in COSLA. I talk quite a lot about, I've got two children at schools in Glasgow. The black minority ethnic population in our schools in Glasgow is now at 18%. When I started working in Glasgow as a social worker a number of years ago, it was 3.2%. So that transformation in terms of our young people's experience in our schools, I think has really enriched the experience of all Glaswegians, and I'm particularly proud of what it is that we've managed to achieve, but not complacent, because I think we can always continue to learn. And we need to make sure that our practice is amongst the best. Where we are now, Derek's quite right. When we held the contract, it was accommodation and support. And we were really clear that particularly the integration piece about how you worked with local communities in Glasgow and how you best supported asylum seekers and refugees was through that support mechanism. So it was really important that they had links to local schools, links into local communities, links to their local GP. We had good links and continue to with colleagues in Police Scotland. And that support element was at least as important as the accommodation and our experience. And one of the, I think, deficits in the current contract is that it has essentially become an accommodation contract, and that support piece has been lost. And I think in losing that support element to the contract means that the experience of asylum seekers in the city of Glasgow is different to that which it was when that contract was held by the local authority, and the store we put in the support context there. We work with the accommodation providers and with the Home Office trying to mitigate that and to make sure that when people get status, they're known to us as soon as possible. And we work with the refugee. We've continued to keep specialist teams, so we've still got an asylum and refugee team in our homelessness service who've had that experience. In fact, the team leader was the person who met the plane from Kosovo. So that we've got a real length and depth of experience in that team, and we've continued to ring fence that because we recognise that there are particular needs that the refugee population have once they get status. And we are working just now with the RSL sector in Glasgow because we think the homelessness, one of the lessons we're learning currently is that the homelessness route is perhaps not the best way in terms of looking at permanent accommodation. So there is an ongoing learning in relation to how we work with refugees once they get status. We've had to pick up issues round about connections into communities and into local health and education services that you wouldn't have seen in the past when we had the contract. So in some of those refugees we're working with, even if they've been in Glasgow for a long time, we are still having to work with them in relation to that support because it's not been around. So that's a thing that's changed for us. We also have a specialist unaccompanied asylum seeking team and have had for the last 9 years in the city. And we've currently got a caseload of 147 unaccompanied asylum seeking children in the city. We continue to see young people present in Glasgow on a weekly basis, but we've also very specifically engaged through COSLA in terms of the young people who were in the Cali camp and in November of last year we took 19 young women from France. We did offer more places, up to 35, but it was 19 young women who arrived. Particular piece of work, that team's got a really significant experience around working with that group of young people. And at this point in time, we are halfway through the development of a new scheme of carers for children, young people who are unaccompanied, 16 and 17-year-olds. We have identified through faith communities in the third sector, specifically positive action and housing, a group of 85 families who have expressed an interest in offering accommodation and support to an unaccompanied asylum-seeking young person. And we are about two-thirds of the way through those assessments. That's not been tried anywhere else in the UK. Scottish Government colleagues are particularly interested in. Again, we've made sure that we've been working with Derek and his team in keeping up to date with other local authorities who are very interested in what we're doing. Partly that comes from our experience about working with refugees, because it's essentially given an opportunity for local community in Glasgow to offer something practical. And what we got from the local communities when we held information sessions was a really strong sense from Glaswegians that they needed to do something practical to offer an alternative to some of the rhetoric that was around in relation to asylum and refugee, even with some of the images from the Calais camp. So we have given people that opportunity to do something practical. We're currently undertaking those assessments. As I say, we're about two-thirds of the way through there. We expect to be able to offer family-based placements from the end of April, beginning of May, and we've been matching young people to families, continuing to offer support. They'll still be looked after children, so we still have an allocated social worker, and we'll work with a guardianship project as well. In terms of the particular focus of this committee in relation to destitution and insecure immigration status, it's long been a difficult issue for us in Glasgow, partly because we've been so successful as a city and as a country in terms of holding on to people once they have a decision, if that decision is a negative decision. We've got very experienced lawyers within that work for the City Council, and again, it's because they've had that experience from when we first took asylum seekers. They've developed some real expertise around about the legal situation. We do have policy guidance for staff, which is on our website, in terms of what the legal situation is. And we've attempted to give some support to our staff to work their way through that legal system. Our chief solicitor has actually written some advice for SOLAR in relation to that. Currently, our position is that on a case-by-case basis, we will look at particularly families where there are dependent children. And if the only issue is destitution, then we are very clear that the Children Scotland Act means that it's not appropriate to accommodate those children in care. We're very clear about that. Contrary, I know, to some of the evidence you may have heard, that's very clear in our guidance, which is public guidance, and I'm happy to share that with the inquiry. We do, however, do an assessment on that case-by-case basis. We aren't trained at this point in time in the No Recourse Public Funds Human Rights Assessment. The legal view is that our GRFEC assessment, given that it's based on the Children Scotland Act, which is based on the UN Convention of the Rights of the Child, is in essence our human rights assessment for children and families. And if we have a GRFEC assessment, which we have to have, and that determines that those children are best looked after within their own family, then we offer support to those families in terms of accommodation and subsistence. The year to date, we've offered support to 31 families in Glasgow. And you can imagine that's a significant cost. We're not a housing authority in Glasgow, just to add a further complication. So we can't house people who have no recourse to public funds in our own housing because we don't have any. So we've had to either use temporary furnished accommodation or private lets, because you can't take a Scottish Assured tenancy through the RSL sector for people who have no recourse to public funds. So we have significant accommodation costs in relation to that. We make sure that those families are continued to be reviewed throughout their time with us. In adults, it is slightly trickier. We do use the community care legislation. And if through an assessment of need, an adult has needs beyond destitution, then we will offer support and subsistence. And in the year to date, that's been five adults that we've offered that kind of support to. We have a significant cohort in the unaccompanied asylum-seeking children population who are appeals right exhausted and have no recourse to public funds. We take the view, which hasn't been challenged yet as to whether or not it's legally competent, but we take the view that those young people are care leavers and should be treated as such now until the age of 26 with the legislation that we have in Scotland, which is different from the legislation in England and Wales. And we do offer support to young unaccompanied asylum-seeking children, which is equivalent to the support we offer care leavers. So it includes access to Section 29 grants in terms of independent living. We've got a much higher cohort of those young people in Scotland than anywhere else. Our success, I would call it success rate in terms of young people getting a positive decision, it's about 50% in Scotland and 30%.
24%, I think, is the last figure, so in the rest of the UK.
In the rest of the UK. So we are particularly successful working with colleagues in the third sector about getting positive decisions. But that, if you think about that cohort of 147 as our current caseload, roughly about 50% of them are likely to get to a position where they will not be supported. So that cost then would come to the local authority. The position, convener, that we are in terms of offering support, as I said, it is clearly laid out for our staff. The final decision is mine as Chief Social Work Officer, because our position is that it's a professional decision in the interests either of children or vulnerable adults that's made in terms of no recourse to public funds. The costs then fall into us as a local authority. We have not yet been challenged in court. Our lawyers are clear we have a defendable position, but are not clear that we have a legally competent position. Again, we've been quite upfront about that, and we have had support from across our council, so it's not a political point, it's been across our council. We haven't had, we've had full cross-party support in terms of the position that we have taken in relation to policy. So apologies, that was probably more than my 1 minute, but it is quite a lot to squeeze in.
There is a lot to investigate and a lot to hear. Thank you. We'll come back with some questions in a wee second. Once we've heard from Alistair, you've got a unique position in all of this because you've got the balance to make between asylum and refugees feeling safe when maybe they've came from countries where the police were not safe. So you've got that balance with communities who want to feel safe as well. And you've obviously got some of the people that get caught in the middle of that, who maybe find themselves homeless, who are sleeping rough, who maybe be exploited, who may be subject to trafficking or other exploitation in that way, or may find themselves, in order to survive, end up going down a criminality route themselves. So that you've got a very fine balance there in how you care for an individual, but how you exercise the law as well. So we're keen to hear how you do that, really.
Okay, thank you, convener. Really, law enforcement fully understands that those that fall into vulnerability, in whatever circumstance they come from, as we've heard from Olivia, then they become vulnerable to others. You know, it's the old adage of, if society is not engaging with individuals, criminality will. So there's an element of that criminals will look into, well, these individuals are not being cared for. You know, so we need to be alive to that, certainly. I canvassed a lot of my colleagues to from different departments to see, well, what do we know about destitution, asylum and insecure immigration? Not a lot is actually categorised as such. We have different categories for people in our systems, but this is, I would call, an emerging issue for policing. Not that we're unaware of it by any means, but in terms of looking into it in a greater detail, using analytical products to look at it. In terms of the community, we have officers, we're a national police force, which gives us a great strength for across Scotland, for training officers to work in local communities, which is at the heart of policing. And so communities that we've had experience of from the Vulnerable People's Relocation Scheme, the Syrians coming over, we've been able to train officers across the country in our 13 divisions and elsewhere in how to, what's the background to these individuals, how to deal with them, how, what your point is there, convener, about they've come from where law enforcement is distrusted, to say the least. How do we break that barrier? How do we possibly move into the area where there is some trust? So we've certainly been working with our colleagues in COSLA and in Glasgow, and police officers particularly there, because as we've heard already, there's been a lot of experience gained there. Myself and others, officers in Glasgow, we work with refugees on a weekly basis, refugees and asylum seekers, so we've got an understanding. We certainly don't know all, but we have an understanding of some of the issues, be it from the lack of finance, the lack of accommodation, the mental health issues that come from it as well. So we're a learning organisation, and you know, we're working towards that. We've got officers embedded, or deliver additional training to ESOL classes, the learning English language. So we're working towards we're making it safer for these individuals in this category.
Thanks very much, Alistair. Mary, do you want to kick off the open questions?
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. I wonder perhaps if I could start by asking Derek a question, because in the last few weeks of evidence, we've almost had two completely different views on a similar subject, and I see you're smiling, so you probably know what I'm going to ask you. The Refugee Council came along and gave us detail about FOIs that they had done on local authorities and the knowledge and the information that they had about particularly people that had no recourse to public funds. And quite frankly, it was shocking, the responses that the Refugee Council got from local authorities about the lack of knowledge, the lack of information, the lack of work on the ground. And then we had COSLA come along last week and basically told us that they had this wonderful process in place. There was good partnership working. It all filtered down. There was guidance. Local authorities knew about it. And quite frankly, they were a bit surprised that the response that the Refugee Council had had. And perhaps the Refugee Council had asked the wrong questions or the wrong person had answered them. So somewhere in between that is the truth. And I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I would be keen to hear your view on that and how you think whatever the issue is can be solved.
Okay. Yeah, I mean, I watched with interest what Scottish Refugee Council have said. I think, as Andy said last week, you know, we are a partner with Scottish Government, Scottish Refugee Council, in the new Scottish strategy, and I wouldn't have anticipated that we're a partner organisation that you would dip your toe in and out of that whenever it suits you. If the Scottish Refugee Council came to us, we have a no recourse public funds group which actually met yesterday in our offices. We have a number of local authorities that are working on this. Is the level of knowledge and information that local authorities have up and down the country uniform? No. If a social worker gets approached by someone who has no recourse to public funds in an area once every 6 months, they're going to have the same level of knowledge that social work staff in Glasgow or Edinburgh have? No. Is there work to do in that? Yes. We did a piece of work some time ago, and Scottish Government actually funded that work to be done, which gave a strategic oversight of what the issues that local authorities needed to take into account when they were working on this. Carrying an FOI gives you an answer to the specific points that were raised. And I think it wasn't just COSLA last week that said, the local authorities themselves said that there's a use of language around human rights assessments, a use of language around destitution, a use of language around no recourse to public funds, that in essence social work staff on a daily basis don't come into the profession to refuse people services. So what the local authorities have developed is practice that allows them to look at the legal implications and look at the situations that people present with and make decisions on that. So are all the decisions correct? Absolutely not. Is there work to be done around that? Yes. We don't have any funding to refresh that guidance. But as I say, I don't think the picture that's been painted, and I fully accept what you say, that you know, we'll say one thing and others are saying another. I'm not convinced, absolutely, that the level of knowledge in local authorities is as poor as what's been presented to this inquiry. Nowhere near it.
I mean, the Refugees Council's view was that the guidance needs urgently updated. And the guidance needs urgently updated with the working and the cooperation of all the partners that feed in and work together. Now, I accept that you're saying that you don't have the resources to upgrade that guidance. Is it just about money? Is there some other way that guidance could be updated?
Yeah, I mean, the issue about guidance around no recourse public funds is it changes on an almost daily basis. You know, the legislation changes, the expectations on local government, the statutory obligations on them change on a regular basis. You know, we did hope when the guidance was first published that we would be able to go back timeously and refresh that, and it's something that we've not been able to do. So resources is a big issue. I'm not convinced that getting a room full of people will add huge significance to the information that's required for local authorities to make decisions. You know, it's no recourse to public funds. There are quite clearly public funds that low. So when Suzanne talked earlier, when Sean spoke last week, and Alan and others spoke last week about providing services to people with no recourse to public funds. Public funds means housing benefit, tax credits, Scottish Welfare Fund. These are all things that local authorities cannot access. So when local authorities provide accommodation, whether it's in their own accommodation or private sector accommodation, for people with no recourse to public funds, the local authority pays for that service. And I think the convener raised an issue earlier about, you know, we're talking about a range of devolved services here that, you know, it's not my job to say which government should pick up the tab, but quite clearly local authorities seem to be getting a lot of criticism for not doing enough for people when I think they're actually doing quite a lot. But the cards are earning in their favour. You know, we've
to pick up the pieces.
Absolutely. And that cost shunt is continuing with the new Immigration Act that's coming out. It's only going to get worse. And you know what we see is local government with diminishing resources faced with really, really difficult decisions about what they do. In the main, I think they do a pretty good job, frankly.
Okay. Natalia, can I bring Natalia in right now? Because Mary, I think Natalia, your research is probably an independent eye on all of these organisations and the work they do, and maybe you can enlighten Mary. It's a question.
Obviously, I've been following this issue since June now, and I've been supporting Olivia since June. My biggest concern is the actual issue of gatekeeping around this support from local authorities, because I've sat through the meetings and I've sat through the way that the assessment process has been implemented, and that's been of huge concern to me. The actual guidance is actually here, so there is a brilliant report that was done in 2012. And that was establishing migrants' access to benefits and local authority. And it's very clear on page 6, the issue around no recourse to public funds, and it's very clear that social services is not a public fund when it comes to Section 22 and supporting children. All children, regardless of their parents' immigration status, should be provided with adequate housing and adequate financial assistance. However, from my time spent with Olivia, it's been extremely difficult to even have a proper assessment implemented, even when I've advocated for that. It's stated that obviously there's no recourse to public funds policy in place, but the GERFIC assessment does not cover this specific area. It's definitely not been sufficient. And Olivia had to wait 7 months for housing, within which time she had to rely on positive action in housing and networks in the community. That's not their legal responsibility to do that. There's a clear legislative duty. But even in the assessment meetings, it's been disturbing how Olivia has been spoken to, with me being there as an advocate as well. So being called an illegal immigrant in meetings is, I found, highly disturbing and inappropriate. Olivia has an IS 96 form. She's not unlawfully in the UK. And it sets a really destructive tone, especially in terms of social work's taking a human rights perspective, and I find it's been taking more of a Home Office immigration perspective, which is not really social work's remit. So I found that disturbing. I found there's been inaccurate information as well. So when I've taken legal documentation in regards to no recourse to public funds, I've been told that, oh, we can't accommodate Olivia because she's got no recourse to public funds, when actually she's entitled to be accommodated. The way I've been spoken to in meetings has been quite intimidating as well. So I've been challenged. Do I know what my role is as an advocate? So it's been a very grueling time, not just in regards to Olivia, but in other case studies where I've had to challenge the local authority, especially in regards to B&B accommodation. And the only time people have been granted accommodation and financial support is when judicial review has been threatened. So that it should not get to that point, in my opinion. So that those are the issues that we've been facing at ASH, and that what I've been seeing in my research as well as threats to remove children. We can accompany the children, but not the family. I gather that it's very difficult when there's other issues in regards to child protection, but when it's destitution is the only issue, that should be the absolute last resort in regards to the best interests of the child, and it is actually unlawful. What I would advocate is that people need an accompanying scheme when they go to social work meetings, so they need someone there with them, they need an advocate there with them, and even then it's very difficult.
Mary, do you want to come back?
No, I think that explanation has been very, very helpful, and I appreciate that time is tight and colleagues may want to come in, but I just wanted to ask Alistair a very quick question before I allow other colleagues to come in. And I wonder if you could perhaps explain in practical terms what an officer would do, how he would make the distinction if he came across someone in the streets that was perhaps dipping in and out of homelessness, that was vulnerable because they were an asylum seeker, or was someone that had been sleeping on the streets for years. How would they make that differentiation? And what organisations would they signpost them to, and how quickly would that be done?
Yeah, that's obviously quite a complex question in terms of we with any individual that we have to check out, we will check our systems, documented police systems. If our ones at the moment, I think it's quite crude in terms of the Home Office designation of individuals. So we would, if anybody really comes into the immigration status, it would be the Borders Agency, Home Office Borders Agency, that we would contact. And really, it's signposting to them in terms of the individual's status, and their systems would tell us. So we are kind of an agency of what they tell us. In terms of the individuals, if they are taken into custody or if they are, it's a more of a welfare check for them, then through local knowledge within, and we're talking really Glasgow here, we are aware of lots of support groups that are available, night shelters, obviously recourse to our colleagues within the City Council as well. So there's a host of organisations who are there to support the individuals, and we would certainly pass the details on of different organisations to these individuals.
Thank you.
Okay,
Jeremy.
Thank you,
Convener. I've got two questions in two different areas, so I'll maybe go with following up from Mary's point back to Suzanne. I mean, we are hearing very clearly, both written and oral evidence, that you may have the best policies in the world, you may have the best lawyers in the world advising you, but when someone comes face to face on that first occasion, on that second occasion, on that third occasion, with a social worker or with a member of your team, they are having a very negative and perhaps illegal response. Now, these may be exceptions, I suspect not, but they may be exceptions, but that is the evidence that we've got before us. And so the question that I have is, why is this great policy, great procedure, great documents that have been written at Glasgow City Council not getting down to the local social work office or to the local social worker who's dealing with it? Because I saw you shaking your head quite vigorously when we were hearing that. But that is the evidence we're hearing. That's the reality. And my question is, why is that happening?
Thanks very much. I was shaking my head, and I wouldn't expect to come to a public inquiry and talk about individual cases, so I won't. I don't think that's appropriate for me as a professional.
I'm sure there's lots of cases.
No, yeah. I that was in response to the discussion from Katie, so I wouldn't do that. I also, my concern about some of the evidence is the first time I hear about it as Chief Social Work Officer and is when it's presented as evidence to you. Now, there's a really clear escalation process in terms of our third sector partners working within Glasgow. There's a very clear escalation process in terms of our hierarchy in relation to children and families. So you have a social worker, team leader, service manager, head of children's services, then me, then our director. I wouldn't expect to be hearing about poor practice, which it is, at a public inquiry. I would expect people to be raising that with us, and I'm disappointed that that's not happened. Secondly, I think in terms of those 31 families, if you wanted a positive experience of the response from the 31 families over the last year, or indeed the 100 of families that we have supported over the last 10 years, then I'm sure I can find that for you. By definition, what you would hear at an inquiry is, I think where it has gone wrong, I wasn't asked to provide examples of where we have implemented our own policy appropriately and to best practice. I would never be in a position as Chief Social Work Officer of defending poor practice. What you have heard is poor practice, but equally, I wouldn't be expecting to defend it for the first time at a public inquiry. So I'm really clear that some of the evidence that you have been presented with is evidence of poor practice. I would have expected that third sector partners would have allowed me the courtesy of dealing with that prior to coming to a public inquiry, and I haven't been given that opportunity. I don't believe it is. It tells a full story. If you were looking for evidence from people where it's gone well, I would be happy to go back to Glasgow and find that for you.
I think that is not a particularly satisfactory answer. You've given a very procedural response, but you haven't, and I'm not asking you to deal with specific cases, but do you accept that there is an issue going on here within Glasgow, that there are people's experience, particularly with children, who have been denied their legal rights? Do you accept that as that is going on? Are you saying everything is actually wonderful in Glasgow?
I think I was quite clear in saying that some of the evidence that you've heard is evidence of poor practice. So I think I quite clearly stated that that's not procedural. That's my professional opinion as Chief Social Work Officer, and I wouldn't ever be in a position of defending poor practice. What I'm saying to you is the evidence that's come in front of you does not give you evidence of systemic failures in relation to how we respond to people who are destitute. It is an extremely complex area. We do have contrary legal advice to some of the advice that's been given to the third sector. As a public servant, I have to follow my own legal advice, not legal advice from a third sector. So there is not necessarily a consensus in terms of what's legally competent. That said, we are currently acting beyond what our own lawyers believe to be legally competent. So my response to you is, I don't believe that the evidence that you have is evidence of systemic failure. I believe it's evidence of poor practice in individual cases, which I would not defend. I would have expected the opportunity to deal with that elsewhere.
To be absolutely honest with you, Suzanne, we've met with a number of families over the past few weeks and individuals who have been, you know, in my opinion, very badly treated by the system as a whole. Okay, within that, we'll obviously have the people who are in the worst crisis. As politicians, it's always people in crisis that come to us anyway. So we understand that maybe we are getting a view that's the most negative end of that. What we're attempting to do is to see if that's a policy decision or if it's a local decision or if it's one specific social worker even, you know, that's making some of these decisions, and that then becomes a culture. The big worry for us, if there is a culture of any negative or bad practice out there, that however small it is, if the dispersal then goes Scotland-wide, does that bad practice then get shared and travel with it? So we're well aware that we're not expecting you to answer personally for any of the evidence that we have heard. We're trying to get to the bottom of whether this is a systemic thing or if it's a local thing or if it's just some local office culture or whatever. We're trying to get that. Maybe a local office is overwhelmed by the amount of cases that come through the door. We understand that and we accept that. We're getting quite tight for time, and I want to make sure my other colleagues get in. David, you were wanting to come in.
Thank you, Convener. It's just a follow-up with Mary and local authorities. Glasgow has a wealth of experience dealing with asylum and refugees compared to other local authorities in Scotland. How best do you say your best practice? Because my from previous experience, local authorities very seldom communicate with one another when it's best practices.
I wouldn't disagree with your experience generally. In this area, world and humanitarian protection, we work with 32 councils. We have a Syrian resettlement group, a 32 councils that meets every 6 weeks. We have a UASC working group that meets timelessly as well. We have a no recourse to public funds network in Scotland that has, a number of authorities, and we're trying to encourage more authorities to come along because of some of the issues that have been raised and some of the issues we're aware of as well. So, and we have used the experience of the bigger cities, primarily Glasgow, but also Edinburgh as well over time, and we have a knowledge hub for information, so you could have somebody posting something in Aberdeenshire in the morning and somebody from the recent Galloway or Glasgow or Edinburgh answering that question, so you're not duplicating, so that you're using those scarce resources to the best way they can. So across the range of issues and humanitarian issues, there's a collegiality and collaborative nature of working with all of those local authorities that I think maybe is exceptional, but that happens. And I think, you know, other public bodies like the police and others would, you know, who are part of these structures as well, would agree that that's in place.
Thank you.
That's okay. The No Recourse to Public Funds Network, we heard a bit about that last week, but we've had evidence since then to suggest it's not met for 2 years. Is that...
It met yesterday. I'm not sure who gave you the evidence.
Was that the first time for 2 years?
No. I'm not sure who gave you the evidence that it didn't meet for 2 years. But the point about this is, and I'm sorry for coming back to this resourcing issue, I had a member of staff who was tasked with doing this piece of work. You know, when you then get the humanitarian crisis in France and Calais and France and everything that happens, some things need to be set to the side. So what we're trying to do, and it's not because the inquiries meeting that it met, yesterday, but it did meet yesterday. It will continue to meet. We've got the No Recourse Public Funds Coordinator for the UK from Islington, who comes up to that as well. We share best practice. Again, I get going back to, you know, what others have said. We're not saying that things are perfect. We're not saying that practice is uniform throughout Scotland. We would like to get to that point. What we've now got is we've got a situation where 31 of 32 local authorities have got Syrian refugees in their communities. And I think you touched on earlier, convener, the fact that gives 5-year consistency of funding and a level of funding that allows local authorities for the first time to build up a bit of an infrastructure and a bit of a knowledge base around how they're doing things. So we would think the direction of travel for us is a positive one in terms of how local government will respond to these issues. But there does remain, as I get back to the point before, if a Syrian asylum seeker comes into a local authority area through dispersal, they will get put into a house that will be inspected once a month. The house will be inspected once a month, and they'll be given a phone number for Dover for migrant help. If a Syrian refugee comes in through the resettlement programme, local authorities and our third sector partners are involved in the daily lives of these people.
Yeah.
And that's that inclusive nature of how we want to work with everybody.
Yeah. There was a really, really clear comparison and evidence that we've had between the Syrian resettlement scheme. Mm-hmm. So you could have a man from Aleppo, who's made his way across Europe, for instance, and managed to get here for whatever means, and you've got somebody who came through the scheme being treated very, very differently. And from a human rights point of view, in this committee's criteria of its remit, that's very, very concerning, not taking away the work that's been done. Willie's want to come in because we're really battering up against the time limit now. So
yeah, thanks very much, convener, and hello everybody. This has been quite an experience at this committee in this particular inquiry for me and my colleagues, and we've heard so much evidence over the weeks. It's been pretty harrowing. Evidence provided in writing, evidence provided to us in private, and evidence at the committee. And what we've heard from several witnesses is this immigration system is causing many of these problems. And Derek, your opening remarks today to us said that the asylum system is fractured beyond repair. We're hearing stories from people on the ground that there seems to be a battle going on with the system at every level to stop this kind of treatment of people, this inhumanity being meted out in ordinary citizens that we should be doing our best to help with. Now, we understand that you guys are often picking up the pieces in Scotland, and we respect that, and we empathise with that. But we certainly want to get to the root cause of why ordinary people, with many of them with children, are being treated in this disgraceful manner. And we don't want to be able to see and to listen to stories where the system is fighting with itself over bits of legislation. Why on earth is the humanity not being put into this to first and foremost look after people and their children and worry about the legislation and the problems and the guidelines thereafter? Do we need to do something radically different here to get a system in place, either in the UK or in Scotland or both? I don't really care. that stops this kind of treatment of ordinary people and their children, to make sure that there's a more humane approach taken to looking after people that need our help?
Suzanne.
Yeah, if I could answer that, because we have tried to pick our way through that, and it's entirely counterintuitive. I remember being at a cross-party meeting with our own elected members locally, who were coming from a place we must be able to do more than we're currently doing, and who were really taken aback by the briefing that we had from our lawyers, who are taking some risks, they're clear about that, that the primary immigration legislation essentially is saying to local authorities, people who are in this position with no recourse to public funds, you should ignore. That is essentially what the primary legislation in the UK tells you. So we've had to find ways round, particularly using the human rights argument, we've had to find ways round that primary legislation. We haven't had a challenge in Scotland, so we know, again, that the position that we've actually got publicly on our website in terms of how we would deal with that using the Children Scotland Act and Community Care legislation is entirely challengeable in courts through judicial review, and our lawyers are prepped and briefed for that, should that day ever come. My big concern about that is you can't make an assumption in Scotland, because we've seen to have a different approach, that you don't have a cohort of people who will challenge us on that. So I think there is a fundamental difficulty with that, and I'm trying to make sure that's not political, but I've said it now anyway. There's a fundamental difficulty with that primary legislation from Westminster, which essentially tells us that people who have no recourse to public funds should be ignored. Now, and part of the reason it's fractured and part of the reason relationships are difficult is we're all trying to find a way around that. It's not more straightforward. There's a level of confidence that you might have if you deal with it more on a daily basis, where if you were in a very small local authority where you've dealt with it once in the last 5 years, that can be really challenging, because what lawyers there might tell you is you can't do it because we'll be challenged. So that kind of experience can mean there are differences in terms of the approach, but fundamentally that drives a real difficulty, I think, in terms of how we manage people who have no recourse to public funds and how we respond in a humane way.
Derek, could I please hear a response from you? I mean, surely we don't need anybody's permission to act with compassion and humanity.
The evidence that we get from our local authorities, not that I'm aware of, somebody might tell me with this about a successful legal challenge from the third sector about a local authority not performing what they should do and not treating people with compassion. Social work staff don't come into their job on a day and daily basis, convener knows this, not to provide services to people. And I actually think, some of the evidence you've been given to form an opinion, which I can understand, isn't it what we see? We see valued professional social work staff trying to circumnavigate devolved and reserved competencies in a really, really skillful way in the main to try and support people. It does come back to the bit that, we have a blunt policy tool of destitution, mm-hmm. right? And local authorities, increasingly in Immigration Act as well, as time goes on, will be seen to be using be a tool to further the UK government's wish that if someone does not get a valid asylum claim accepted or they're here with no recourse to public funds, that you make life so difficult for them that they'll return. And, the point we've made in the past, and if somebody's coming from Mogadishu and their choice is sleeping in somebody's couch or going back to Mogadishu, I think we would all make the same choices. But the problem we've got is that there's an overt focus on what local government are or aren't doing around this, and there's really no any real focus that I can see on what the UK and Scottish governments can do. There's a hell of a lot of devolved competencies around this as well. So it's not an easy answer, but the evidence we get for local authorities, and normally when you've got such bad practice that's been presented to you guys, you would normally see legal challenges by the score with that. I'm not aware of any, so I'm not convinced that those legal challenges are the practice that local authorities perform on a day and daily basis with very vulnerable people is as bad as it's been painted.
So how do we stop it then from getting worse, as you say? You've said a few times that it's going to get worse. How do we even attempt to intervene? I mean, you're here, it's your opportunity. It's the Scottish Parliament Committee. We're We're desperate to hear your evidence and your advice, so what would it be?
As I said before, it's not a political point. Consecutive UK governments have used destitution as a policy tool, and I don't see that changing in the near future. In local government, we are, you know, basically delivery partners around most of this. We can jump up and down. We can, you know, in terms of the transformation agenda around what the next asylum contracts are going to look like, we can put our stuff in and whatever. My cynical sense is that they're wanting to involve local government in that in the future to bring us in closer to them in terms of how they deliver things and get a consistency around that. It's not about resourcing us to do the job that we all want today. I don't think anybody wants to refuse anybody their services. But there are legal issues around that. So, you know, what the Scottish Government can do, they can continue to talk to UK Government about aspects of immigration system that just are inhumane and don't seem to make sense. But I get back to this point. What we've talked about today in the main is people accessing devolved services. And the Scottish Government have got responsibility for devolved services.
We are sort of a bang out of time. I really don't want to close this session without maybe giving Olivia a final word, to be honest, Olivia, because if you could give us one piece of advice in the work that we are taking forward and the recommendations we can make, Olivia, what would it be?
Honestly, if I had a pen right now and that I had to be given the chance to reverse most of the inhumane treatment legislation that have to be rewritten back again, because there's somebody, a human being, who signed those legislations. They didn't just drop. They're just not paperwork that were just given on every government. And this is something that you cannot have. You can ignore a child for the, because it's a foundations like building a, like this the foundation of is standing because of the good foundation. So for a child to grow up very well, the well-being of a child, you're looking at the foundation and the development of a child. So if we ignore, if you look at the ethnic minorities, children mostly, most of them are even like shattered, like they are zombies, like they can't even talk properly because of that restricted, the barriers surrounding them. They can't access most of the things that other local people can access. You can't even pay for this. You need to pay for a lot of things. Things like Health Start for £3.50 vouchers, I can't access them because I've got no income coming through. That's just for fruit and veg, which I've fought to get this, and it's been refused because I don't have any income. That's £3.50 fruits and vegetables I've asked for. It's never been given to me. My health visitor has tried to apply for it. It still came back negative. So if I had that pain, I would just say, at least for the benefit of a child, the earliest foundation of a child development matters, and we can start from there because we are all passing on. This is a future generation we're raising. So if we're not paying attention to these little ones growing up and we're going off, how is the world going to be? There won't be any world with all this, you know, that's going to be proper. Things will never change. So I think we have to really focus on the little ones. You can punish me, but not a child. You know, I can take the punishment, but not a baby that needs that support. I can take the punishment, but not a baby. So that's my final word.
Natalia.
Can I just add one more thing? It was just currently the fight that we're having at the minute is to provide Olivia for appropriate financial assistance. Olivia is living on £25 a week for herself and a baby. That, to me, is inhumane. In 2014, Glasgow City Council had a response to the inquiry into asylum support, and they actually recommended that a family with the first child should be receiving £89 per week. Olivia's assistance at the minute is dramatically under £89 per week, and I've tried to advocate that increases, and we're both really struggling with that gruelling fight at the minute. So yeah. I'd just like to end on that point.
That's a point well made. We are so completely out of time now that I think we could have spent a lot more time. And in all of our panels, we've been always ran out of time because there's so much more we can speak about. Can we thank you for coming along today, for being so open and candid with us? It's not an easy subject. And when I said we're shining that light, it's shining it on us all. And in some cases, that's going to be uncomfortable for most of us. not least the people who are having to come from some of the situations and give evidence to the committee. So we are very grateful for your contributions. If you go away and you think we should have said something, I should have mentioned something else, I should have reinforced something else, please, please do that, because we've still got another few weeks before we compile our final report, and we want that report to be as informed as possible with as much factual-based information as possible. So your help in that would be gratefully received. So I thank you so much, and I'm going to suspend committee to go into private.